It's the red deer that we have here, a population of about 450 of these animals. And of course, the water hole is open all hours and the deer are constantly coming down and drinking, but also wallowing, because they're molting at this time of year and they like to roll in it because it makes it less itchy and maybe even gets rid of a few parasites too.
There's loads of different animals that you can see around that water hole, and the grassy plains are the perfect place for one of the most common mammals on Minsmere to hang out. It's rabbits. As you can see there, there are quite a lot of them, hundreds of rabbits. They're adorable, they're abundant, they're prolific breeders. So does that mean that the whole of Minsmere is going to be overrun by rabbits? Well, no, it doesn't, because they're also perfect fodder for a lot of birds of prey and also this mammal, the fox. You can see our wily fox there is on the prowl. And he's looking at a bite to eat, a rabbit. He's chasing the rabbit. Does he get it? The others don't seem too concerned. But no, but this particular point, he didn't. He's got fluff in
he's
his mouth,
hasn't
he?
He's had a mouthful of fur, so he must have come close, yeah.
Does he try again? I think he might, because there's certainly plenty of them around. And yes, he finally grabs his dinner. So they're kept under control, aren't they?
Lots of things are eating rabbits, there's no doubt about that at all. But they do a lot of eating themselves. And through their grazing, they maintain another habitat here. And it is that short, grassy land, short, grassy heathland that we've got here, sandy. And on it are a particular set of birds, including this specialist, the stone curlew. They're a very rare bird. They have two centres for their population, really, in the UK, Breckland and Salisbury Plain, a few up here on the Suffolk Soundings. But look at that, Michaela, look at that eye.
That's a fabulous eye.
They're crepuscular. They hunt visually in low light, so they need a big eye. But, you know, in days gone by, people used to go out and catch stone curlews, put them in a box and cover it with a piece of cloth, and then charge people with jaundice to look at them. Because they thought that that eye would suck the jaundice out of you. So if you had jaundice, you'd go up, give someone a fiver, or, I don't know, a couple of groats or something, and they'd whip the cover off, the stone curlew would stare at you like that, and you'd be cured.
If only it was that easy.
Yeah. From one weird and wonderful bird, and weird and wonderful story, to a weird and wonderful bloke. Martin.
Thank you very much, Chris. Right, let's leave the sea, let's go along here, do a little pas de deux, and let's look across Minsmere. Here we are again. And there, that wet area, that's the scrape there. Now, we're going to keep coming back to the scrape for the next 3 weeks. Why is it called the scrape? Well, it is literally scraped. The top surface, the vegetation, is scraped off by the RSPB to provide bare earth, because a lot of the birds, some of the rare birds that breed here, need that bare earth to actually nest on. And they have to keep doing that regularly to keep it bare. What is nesting there now? We have live cameras down there. Let's have a look what we can see on the scrape. And there you can see that iconic bird, the avocet, on its nest. And the black gulls, black-headed gulls behind. Now, the avocet was extinct in the UK for 100 years, hunted and egg collectors made sure of that. And then in 1947, it reappeared right here, and that was such a conservation success. That was the reason the RSPB used this bird as its symbol, the avocet. Now, we've been following avocets down here. There's about 45 pairs nesting down on the scrape, and we've been following them. Now, the first thing that they do when they arrive here, they have a really beautiful, ritualized courtship behavior. What happens is they get very excited, they dabble that upturned bill in the water, that's a female, the male's rushing around, he'll jump on top, he'll copulate, and as soon as they've finished, he'll put his wing around his mate there and they'll walk off together. Very beautiful, delicate courtship. Now they'll work together, they're monogamous, they'll work together throughout the whole year, selecting little bits of reeds to make that nest, and look, she's laid the eggs. You can see how thin and fine that bill is, and they'll take it in turns there to come in and incubate the eggs. Very difficult to tell the difference in the male and female. The male's bill is slightly longer than the female's, but very hard to tell. gorgeous. Now those bill, that curved, that upcurved bill, is used by them to sweep through mucky water looking for prey. But what are they eating? Well, I can show you with a bit of luck. They're looking for these. We've got all sorts. We've got shrimps, we've got a damselfly larva, we've got little water boatmen in here, all sorts of things. A little seafood cocktail, brackish water cocktail. It's rather delicious, actually. If I wasn't vegetarian, I might have a little go. Imagine a bit like oysters. Thank you very much. Now, they're nesting there on the scrape, but it's a slightly risky strategy because have a look at where they're nesting. Here it is, and here's the avocet coming in to protect it, but just behind the avocet is a large colony of black-headed gulls. Now that is good news, and it's also bad news. The black-headed gulls will provide some sort of defence for the avocet. If any predators come in, they all whoosh up into the air, and they'll try and see that predator off. But here's the bad news. Unfortunately, black-headed gulls sometimes eat avocet chicks, so we're going to have to keep a very careful eye on what's going on down there. So now, for the rare and wonderful creatures here in Minsmere, to the less rare but equally wonderful animals in your own backyard. After a rain-soaked winter, spring has arrived early in the garden. Plants and animals alike shake off the shackles of the cold, wet months. A two-spot ladybird awakens. She spent the winter hibernating in the shed. Now that warmth has returned to the garden, the race is on to breed. Hungry and dehydrated, her first task is to find food. In the rose bushes, a wasteland of discarded aphid skins sets her on the right path. These are the clues she was looking for. Nearby, an aphid colony. This little lady hasn't eaten in months, and she immediately gets stuck into the banquet. She'll eat up to 60 aphids a day. Little wonder gardeners love them. Our female isn't the only two-spot at large in the garden. Males are also on the hunt, and they're not looking for food. It's love they're after. Encounters are a random affair, but there's no time for tender caresses. Individuals literally bump into each other and get going, and going, and going. Female ladybirds are highly promiscuous, so when a male gets his girl, it pays to hang on to her. The pair will mate for up to 8 hours. Not long after this mating marathon, she lays clutches of eggs. Over the spring, she'll lay 1,000 eggs, and timing is key. She needs her young to take advantage of the seasonal glut of prey. Depending on the weather, the eggs take up to 5 days to hatch. They darken as the developing embryos grow. And finally, they're ready. Emerging head first, the larvae pump up their blood pressure to free themselves from their shells. As soon as they're out, these miniature eating machines set off on their path of destruction. First, they eat the egg from which they've hatched and any that haven't developed. Then, they turn their attention to their brothers and sisters.
Sibling cannibalism is rife in two spots, so it pays to hatch first. There's nothing like a quick entree before the main course, which is, of course, juicy, honey-filled aphids. The sole purpose of these larvae is to grow. And grow. And grow. And when it's molted three times, this little beast is ready to make its penultimate transformation. Emerging from the final larval stage, a pupa. Soft at first, over the next few hours, the outer layer hardens into a solid pupal casing. After a few days, signs of life are visible. And what climbs out is opalescent and beautiful. A dewy, fresh, monochrome ladybird is born. Immediately after birth, she's soft-bodied and vulnerable. But over the next few hours, she'll harden and her bright colours and spots will develop. By autumn, her own offspring will be adult ladybirds. They'll overwinter back in the shed and emerge next spring, ready to continue the cycle all over again.
It really is fascinating to see such a familiar species in such detail. It reminds us not to take ladybirds for granted. And in fact, we mustn't take the two-spot ladybird for granted because it's in real trouble. It's declined 44% in the last 10 years. And that's largely due to the invasive harlequin ladybird, which looks like this. Quite difficult to spot because there's so much colour variation, and all these photographs have been sent in by viewers on our Flickr photographs. But these are the ones that you're more likely to see in your houses, in warm little corners under the stairs and maybe by the windows. And they are voracious predators of the two spots. And they have spread dramatically over the UK. How do we know this? Well, it's because the public have told us through citizen science and a ladybird survey, which is ongoing. So please let us know everything that you find out about ladybirds, whether they're in your house, outside, what they're doing, what species they are. If you don't know, take a photograph, and what their location is, and send that into the website. All the details of that survey are on the website. That's bbc.co.uk/springwatch. And they'll be talking more about ladybirds on Unsprung, which will start straight after we've finished at 9 o'clock on the red button and online as well with Nick Baker.
First animal that I ever met, ladybird.
How do you remember that?
Well, my mum used to say I crawled around the garden. I was absolutely fascinated with them. I'd get them on the end of my finger and I'd just stare at them like this until they took off. And occasionally, of course, if you do put a ladybird on your finger, you'll know that they do this thing, reflex bleeding, where they release a fluid from their knees. It's green, in fact. And it contains a chemical called isopropyl methoxypyrazine. And if you lick it, it tastes really bitter. And in fact, if there are any parents out there, if your kids haven't licked their fingers after they've been bled upon by ladybirds by the time they're 10, you're doing them a great disservice, I've got to tell you. Make sure they get that contact with wildlife. Anyway, from one iconic species to another. Listen to this. It's unmistakable, of course. It is the cuckoo.